Good morning, everybody. Hey, good morning. So glad to see you all today. What an awesome day to be in the Lord's house. If you were coming back from Jingle Jam last night, raise your hand. I just want to give you a round of applause. We had a really great time last night. Thank you so much to everybody who helped make last night possible and to everybody who attended. What a special celebration of Christ coming to us in a new and fresh way. Well, part of the season that we're in right now is Advent. And in the rich tradition of the church throughout the ages, Advent is a season of preparation. It's a time where we make room in our hearts for the miracle of Christmas once again. As the song says, let every heart prepare him room. This season is to help us to truly understand the Christmas story in a new way so that it can change us again as it always has. But it's also a time that we anticipate Christ coming to us again in final victory and glory. We believe that as the Messiah once came, he will come again to set everything straight, to usher in eternity. And as the scriptures teach us, as we learned a couple of weeks ago, not even Jesus knows the time that the Father has intended for this to happen. But we've got to be ready. And so Advent calls us, even as we remember the meaning of Christmas for us, it calls us to prepare our hearts and our lives for Christ to come in our midst once again. And so to mark this tradition of waiting, we light candles each week. Last week we lit a candle in honor of Christ, our hope, and today we light our second candle. I am just overjoyed to have W.E. and Tammy Prillamon here. They are Watersheadians. Yes, please give it up for them. They are nomadic now, but they are here. And y'all can talk about being nomads here in a second, but we're glad that you're home today to celebrate this day with us.
A reading from Luke 3:2-6. The word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance.
As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, making straight path for him. Every valley shall be filled, every mountain and hill shall be made low. The crooked roads become straight, the rough ways smooth. All the people will see God's salvation.
We light this candle as a symbol of Christ's way.
May the words sent from God through the prophets lead us to the way of salvation. O come Emmanuel.
How about that snow this week, right? I mean, who thought it was actually going to fall? I mean, oh me of little faith. We were excited about it. I love snow, just not enough to have to deal with it very much. It's always nice to visit a place with it and then to come home. And so it found its way here to the Gulf Coast of our beloved South Texas. And what a surprise it was. You know, earlier in the week, the weatherman started talking about, you know, the snow could come into Texas, you know, but I figured it would be kind of Northwest Texas, maybe Lubbock, Amarillo, maybe up there, but you know, it very rarely finds its way to the Gulf Coast. Even if it makes it as far as College Station, it kind of hits Northwest Houston and goes, I don't think so, right? And so they started talking Thursday night before bedtime, like this really could be a possibility for us. And not only so, it could really snow in the hill country, and then it might skip over kind of Northwest Houston, but then really, really snow for us on the coast. And I thought, this is language you don't hear from weather persons very often. You know, maybe I ought to pay attention to it, but I was still skeptical. But not my beautiful bride. She set an alarm for 2 a.m. because that's when they said the snow was supposed to come. And I was skeptical, but, you know, if it was going to happen, I wanted to be a part of it. And so she woke up and went outside and came and got me, and I was delighted to go and see that snow, really the white stuff that people talk about up north, was actually falling on our Gulf Coast area. And so we had fun playing in it, and we even tried to get our 5-year-old up, and he was over it, like, yeah, that's nice, and wanted to roll over. and go to bed. And we tried to say, you don't understand. You won't see this again while you're a kid, probably. And he wasn't having it. So we went out and played, and it was great. And we thought, it's probably not going to stick. The ground's too warm, so we're just going to enjoy it while it's falling. Boy, there was a peace out and about at that time that's unlike many other times that we experience. I mean, usually from our home, we can hear the traffic on 96 coming by, and usually big trucks and everything come by at all hours of the night, but it was just completely quiet. Just an amazing moment, almost eerily silent in that hour. And so we went back to sleep, and I thought, okay, I'm so glad that we got up because, you know, we won't be here in the morning. And so I got up, and I was excited to get ready and look out the window, and there was snow on the ground. There was snow on our trees. There was snow on our furniture. And I thought, how in the world did it stick? This is awesome. So I was the one running in to tell Rachel, hey, the snow stuck. This is awesome. So we went and got our kids up. And our five-year-old actually was a little more excited. We said, hey, look out your window. We didn't preface him with snow. You know, we wanted him to be surprised. And he was, oh, my first snow day. I mean, it was an incredible moment. And we went in to get our two-year-old up. And he was kind of like, didn't have a frame of reference for it, like whatever. Until he ran to the window and went, Daddy, it's snow. It was the cutest moment in the world. And so we went outside, got all bundled up, and played in it for a little bit. Because like the song Frosty the Snowman, you better go and have some fun before it melts away. And so we did snow angels, and we built a little 3-inch snowman, and that was really great. And the kids, they just loved it. But my favorite memory from Friday, and I'll always treasure this, is the sound of joy in the neighborhood. You know, the night before at 2 a.m., it was completely still and silent. But man, at 7 o'clock in the morning, the children in the neighborhood were up and out and playing, and there was the sound of laughter and, I mean, little bitty snowballs being thrown at brothers and sisters and dads and moms. And it was a joy that I hadn't heard in our neighborhood. There were no other sounds except the sounds of children, young and old, let's be honest, just celebrating what God had done. Well, this is a season that we celebrate joy and we celebrate peace. And so what a gift given to us by God this Friday to send us this surprisingly early winter snow here on the Gulf Coast of our South Texas. Well, we are learning during the season of Advent and Christmas to follow about the songs found in Scripture that tell about the birth of Jesus, both those songs that anticipate the coming of a Messiah and those that celebrate his arrival. So last week we looked at a song all the way back in Isaiah chapter 9 that surprisingly comes up again today. And over the next few weeks we're going to look at songs in our New Testament that celebrate the coming of Jesus. There are three songs actually at the beginning of Luke's gospel that kick it off that are important to understanding what Luke's all about and how he's telling his story. And so today I want to look with you at one of these old ancient songs in the gospel of Luke that tells of joy and it tells of peace in the anticipation of what God is going to do in the world. And so we know this is Zechariah's song. If you have your Bibles in Luke 1, you see those that title sections of the Bible usually title this Zechariah's song. But in the church circles and in church tradition, it's known by its first word in Latin, which was the practice for many years, the Benedictus. And so if you ever Google that and you want to find some great choral arrangements of this, you can find it by its Latin name. But today we're just going to dig into the Zechariah's song. Now, Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth were the mom and dad of John the Baptist. And we spend a lot of time during the season in church talking about John the Baptist. We don't talk much about Zechariah, and we don't talk much about Elizabeth. So today I want to tell their stories so that we give the song that John's father, Zechariah, sings some context. This is such a meaningful and transformative story. It's pretty amazing. So a little background. So Zechariah is a priest. And he was born into a family of priests. He had served as a priest his whole working life. And he was well advanced in years, as the scripture tells us. He was married to a woman named Elizabeth. Elizabeth was the daughter of a priest. She grew up in a priestly family. And so we joke about preacher's kids in my circles, PKs, we call them affectionately. And usually PKs grow up to be nothing like people think they should because they grow up in church all the time and they meet nobody's expectations for their behavior, right? And so, you know, raising two little PKs myself, I am well aware, right, of kind of how things go. So Zechariah and Elizabeth were PKs for all intents and purposes. Yet, Luke describes them nonetheless as righteous, and then a word he uses for nobody else in the entire gospel, blameless. He says Zechariah and Elizabeth are righteous and they're blameless. They're seated in the religious practice of the nation of Israel, God's chosen people, and they're about as devout as you can get, is what Luke's telling us. A very special couple. Now, something to know about them is that their entire married life, they desperately wanted to have a child of their own. They prayed and they prayed and they prayed, and they never were able to have a child. And apparently they still continued to pray even in their older years, even beyond the age of childbearing, where it even made sense. I mean, if it happened for Abraham and Sarah, it could happen for them. And so they continued to pray, and yet no child. So when Luke opens his gospel with Zechariah's story, have you ever noticed that? After some a few verses of just introductory material, Zechariah's on stage. And he is in the temple. This is his week to serve. Now, priests were divided into 24 groups, which each served 2 weeks out of the year. This is going to be important in just a minute. And so this was Zechariah's week to serve with his group in the temple. Now, the way that the thing that's so special about this story is that Zechariah gets chosen to do something that only happens once in a priest's lifetime, and that's to go into the holy place, the inner sanctuary. The place is called the Holy of Holies in the Old Testament, the place where the presence of God was believed to dwell among the people, and he was to minister there. Now, this is an amazing story. It is the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Now, if you are a priest, this is as good as it gets. I mean, this is like American Idol for the priesthood, right? This whole, have you gotten to go in the Holy of Holies yet? And this was so special that when your group is up and it's time to select who's going to go into the inner sanctuary, a list is made only of those who have not yet gone, and then lots are cast to choose the one off the list. And so lots were a way of kind of discerning God's will and direction. So if the lot fell upon the person who had not been in there before, it was God's will that they go and minister in the presence of God in the inner sanctuary. Why is all this important? Because the lot fell to Zechariah as Luke's gospel opens. Here's this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And he's advanced in years. And can you imagine how giddy he must have felt? Like, I get to go in the inner sanctuary. This is awesome. You know, almost like Will Ferrell, the elf, when Santa comes to the department store, you know, Santa! You know, that kind of thing. He must have really kind of felt that. And so here's the scene. So he's getting ready to go into the inner sanctuary to offer incense on the altar of the Lord. Let me fix my microphone here. And worshipers gather outside. Now, this was a dangerous venture for a priest, because it was believed that you cannot stand in the presence of God and live, which is why you had a people who are set apart, who are holy, who live all their lives in worship and prayer and all of that. They're the only ones who can enter that holy place. And in some places, even the traditions talk about how a rope was tied around the ankle of the priest who went in case they died in the presence of God and had to be retrieved, because nobody else except the one upon whom the lot fell could go. I mean, this is risky business, so worshipers, prayers are gathered around the inner sanctuary for this sacrifice to be made. And so they start praying, and Zechariah enters this place in the presence of God. So you've got this scene set up, once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, excitement abounds, people are there praying for the people, praying for the nation, probably praying for Zechariah as he goes in, and this is what happened on that day. Check this out. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." Notice he doesn't call her old. That's a great practice, man. You should hear Zechariah in this moment. The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel." It's like, how can I know this is going to take place? I'm old? Well, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you the good news. And now you will be silent. You will not be able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time. Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering, these are the worshipers there, wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them and remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. The Lord has done this for me, she said. In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. What a day for Zechariah. I mean, you get to do the thing that you wish your whole career for. He's there in the presence of God in the inner sanctuary. People are praying. And if that wasn't cool enough, as he walks in there beside the altar that he's supposed to be offering incense on, and by the way, Luke never tells us if he ever did what he was supposed to do while he was in there. I would have forgotten, honestly, because, hello, an angel, right? Right there. And so he's greeted and he's in fear, which, by the way, if you read about encounters with angels, that's the first response is fear. And angels are very striking, very scary creatures, as we read about in the Bible. And so angels usually first will say, do not be afraid. But once they get all of that out of the way, Gabriel says, your prayer has been answered. That prayer, we learn, is a prayer for a child that Zechariah and Elizabeth had been praying over and over again. And chances are he was praying it even as he entered the presence of God in the inner sanctuary. Your prayers have been answered. So think about this day for just a moment. You've got butterflies because you're doing the thing that you only get to do once in your career, and it's like, you know, oh, I've achieved this, right? You walk in, there's an angel standing by the altar. Now, priests talk. Don't you talk? We all talk to each other about what goes on, right, in your life. Hey, you'll never guess what happened at work today. And so I can imagine the priest eating dinner and saying, hey, you'll never guess what happened today behind the curtain. You know, nobody else can see. I burned myself with the ashes. It was awful. I had to cover up the burn spot with my robe when I snuck out. You know, just conversations like that. But nobody had said, hey, when I was in the inner sanctuary today, I saw an angel, right? So he knows in that moment, like, just struck with awe and wonder. And then to hear, your prayer has been answered. You and your wife Elizabeth are having a son. And if that wasn't good enough, the angel goes on and says, this child will be special. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will turn the hearts of parents to their children and those who are unrighteous to the wisdom of the righteous. He, your son, will prepare the way for the Messiah to come. Can you imagine receiving this news? You're having a kid, and by the way, he's going to usher in the new covenant that has been promised from of old. How do you think you would respond? In awe? Would you fall to your knees? Would you look up to the heavens and praise God? Do you know how Zechariah responded? How can I be sure this is really going to happen? Now think about this. There's an angel standing next to the altar in the holy place, for crying out loud. How can I be sure this is going to happen? That was my first reaction. And then I began to think about this a little bit more. And I'm Zechariah. Now, how often do I pray, but not really expect an answer, a response from God to what I've prayed? How often do I worship, but not expect to encounter the living presence of God in worship? This was Zechariah. He must have been praying the prayer even as he went through the curtain into the holy place. You know, if God hasn't responded out here, perhaps God will respond when I'm in the place that's the closest I can get to him on the planet Earth, right? And so he's probably praying this prayer as he goes through this curtain. Boom, angel. All right, boom, your prayer has been heard. Boom, this is the one to prepare the way for the Messiah. And so here's this priest, righteous and blameless, Luke calls him. And yet he doesn't have enough faith to believe that his prayer would be answered and that God would actually be in the place where God's presence was said to dwell on this earth. I believe we are Zechariah sometimes, that we pray and we hope and we pray some more, but yet we don't expect God to do what we've asked. We don't expect an answer to our prayers. Now, granted, God gives us what we need, not always what we want, but God will answer our prayers. But are you expectant? I mean, do you really believe that God is standing there ready to give you the answer to your prayer, to give you just what you need, to respond to your needs, what you've asked of Him just when you need it the most? Or do you doubt that God's even going to show up? We're here in the sanctuary, in this holy place, in the presence of God. God's presence is with us everywhere, by the way. And God is standing ready to answer our prayers. Zechariah's unbelief led to silence. He didn't say a word. And the angel said, "You won't speak until all of these things have been fulfilled." So here's the lesson, that when we pray, we should eagerly anticipate God's response. So meanwhile, the worshipers are gathered around outside of the Holy of Holies, praying and singing, and probably, you know, "I've run out of all the things I know to pray about. You're supposed to get in and get out. That's the rule. You're taking forever. What's going on in there?" And so Zechariah finally emerges, and he went in speaking, and he came out not able to talk. But Luke says he's making signs to try to explain what's happened. So can you imagine this whole scene? And they knew something amazing had happened, but they didn't know what. Now, the custom was for the priest who had come out of the inner sanctuary to share the priestly blessing from Numbers 22. Got it up here. Let's go to the next verse there, 25. This is definitely not right, but I know it. "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift up his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." That's what they were expecting, not, right? So Zechariah goes home. Elizabeth conceives, becomes pregnant. And do you know what her response was? "Look what the Lord has done for me!" She exclaims with joy. She is so happy that this has happened, that her prayers have been answered. Thank God for the women in our life, right? Here's Zechariah. "How can I believe that this is going to happen?" Gabriel, the angel, is standing right there in front of him, right? And here's Elizabeth going, "This is the best thing that's ever happened," like the Will Ferrell moment in the department store with Santa in the Elf movie. That's Elizabeth. Joy should be our response to the mercies of God. Where's God's mercy at work in your life? Mercy is this unmerited, undeserved grace. It's God sees where you are and what you've done, and yet he loves you anyway and wipes away your sin. And you know, we have this condition in our culture today where we dwell on what we haven't done, what hasn't met our expectation, instead of giving thanks for what God is doing or what has been achieved. And I believe this, if we would begin to focus more on blessing and thanksgiving rather than negativity and pessimism, we would be able to see more clearly all of the things that God does for us every single day. But our position for seeing that and to living that way is joy. It is joy. Look what happened. The baby John was born, just as he was, 9 months happened, and there's the baby, right? And here's what it says. "When it was time for Elizabeth to have her baby, she gave birth to a son." Look at this. "Her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown her great mercy, and they," what? "Shared her joy." Friends, joy is contagious, isn't it? Just like pessimism and negativity are contagious as well, and gossip is contagious, so is joy. And so if we have the choice, I'm going to spread negativity and look at the worst in a situation, or I'm going to spread joy and thanksgiving because what God has done, what is the better choice? Joy! Yes! Joy is the much better choice. Elizabeth and Zechariah began to see the world change because of their joy. And what do people do when they have great news? They go and share it. That's how the gospel spreads, through the joy of God's people. This beginning of Luke's gospel, this is part of our Christmas story, and it begins with joy and expectation. And it's wonderful to behold. Well, meanwhile, Zechariah is still sitting there silent because Elizabeth celebrated, and he didn't believe the angel that was standing there. And so it comes time to name the child. Now, the custom is that the father names the child. The wife bears the child. The husband names the child and therefore receives the child as his own, kind of in their thought in that ancient time. So he couldn't talk, so the family was speculating, well, we clearly should name the child after his father, Zechariah. And Elizabeth says, no, his name is John. Then they hand a tablet to Zechariah so he can write, and he writes, his name is John. And immediately, this is what happened. I'll just put the verse up there. Immediately his mouth was opened, his tongue set free, and he began to speak. What did he speak? Praising God. Finally, the thanksgiving and the joy pours forth from his lips. And consequently, in the prophetic literature, you read Hosea, some of the prophets, names matter. And it was common in this tradition for prophets to have children that have names that speak to the nation of Israel what God's intentions were. Do you know what John means? God has been gracious. God has been gracious. So here it is. He gives joy for God's graciousness, his mercy. You see, this keeps coming up again and again and again. And then he sings this song. Now, I don't know if your house is like mine. We walk around singing all the time. It's like living in a Disney movie. If you're around my children for any length of time, you're going to hear them singing. And I think it's switch mics here. This is much better. So you would kind of have this response here. Zechariah breaks into song like a Disney movie, and it's pretty awesome. And so here's, he's filled with the Holy Spirit, and this is what he says. Ready? Praise be to the Lord, Benedictus. Right? Bless the Lord is another way to translate that. The God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, and said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies and to enable us to serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all of our days. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare a way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of sins. Because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. You wish the melody had been preserved. I'd love to just burst forth with this, but it would sound crazy. But somebody, we need to get to work on that aria. We'll need to write that musical setting for that. That's going to be awesome. So there are three themes. There's so much here. But Zechariah lifts up three themes. And they emerge out of his life and the experience in the inner sanctuary and the birth and everything. And here it is. You've got to know that he sings this song, first and foremost, as if everything that he sang about has already taken place. But it hasn't. The baby is little. I mean, he's just been born. Jesus has not even been born yet. He hasn't taught a single person anything. And yet John sings this in eager expectation, note the change, that these things will happen in the future. That teaches us a lot about faith, doesn't it? Faith lives today as if tomorrow is already here. Can you sing a song about God's promises coming true even before they're completely fulfilled? That's a lesson for all of us in the Christmas story, because we know the rest of it. So let me lift up the three themes that are here. First, Zechariah sings about salvation. Now you have to understand, the people of Israel were thinking about salvation in a very particular way. And as you read the Gospels, this comes up again and again. They were looking for a conquering king, a Messiah who would overthrow the Roman government, their political oppressors, and put a king descended from the line of David back on the throne again. That was the end of what they believed about salvation and their hope of the Messiah in a lot of ways, just in short. There's a lot more there. But Zechariah flips this. He says, that will happen. Salvation means peace, and the conditions for peace have to be necessary, but it's not an end in of itself. Here's the reason why. You want to see this? And this, I'm not quite here yet, so y'all don't read ahead. But it's so that we can live in holiness and righteousness and serve God every day
without fear. One author said that we are saved for uninterrupted worship. So salvation is for the sole purpose of living as God intends for us to live, in righteousness and holiness all our days, to serve Him without fear. Can you hear this? Joy, peace. There's another thing about salvation, and this comes through John. Now, John is known as a prophet. Did you know that Israel had not heard from a prophet since Malachi? And their hope was, once a prophet appeared, that they were ushering in the Messianic age. The new covenant would come in fulfillment of Jeremiah 31, 34. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to each other, "Know the Lord," because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. How is John in Zechariah's song to teach about salvation? By the forgiveness of sins. Talk about living without fear of punishment, fear of anxiety, fear of political opposition overtaking you. The words, "your sins are forgiven," bring the most peace in the world, because you're no longer bound by the consequences of that. In those conditions, you can be truly free. That is salvation. The second theme that is brought up here is mercy. Did you hear mercy throughout the whole story of Zechariah and Elizabeth up to this point? Several times. Well, it comes up again. Through this coming Messiah, which is the first part of the song, God is showing mercy to His chosen people, the people who have chosen idols over God time and time again throughout history. He's saying now in this new age to come, God's going to show mercy. Forget about all that. What does mercy mean? Mercy is this: it's kindness or goodwill toward the miserable and the afflicted, with a desire to help. So what mercy isn't is, bless her heart, with no intent to do anything other than just to kind of scoff and go, glad that's not me, right? Mercy's different. Mercy always has the desire to help, to do something. It moves you to compassion. Mercy is what we saw in the aftermath of Harvey here in our community and are still seeing, that moves people to want to do something to help. It's not pity, it's action. It's action. So mercy is brought up several times, and mercy is shown to God's people. And third and finally, peace is the final theme I want to lift up today. This absence of political oppression, this absence of fear of punishment, this absence of anxiety, this is the condition where we can live life as God fully intends. We hear echoes of Isaiah 9 from last week come back into view. Behold, a people walking in darkness have seen a light, and those who are walking in deep darkness, a light has come. Zechariah sings the same thing. He says that God's sun is breaking in, shining light upon us to guide us on the path of peace. Isaiah 9 fulfilled. In Jesus and in John, God is gracious, the one to prepare the way for the coming Messiah. So friends, we had a great reminder this week of God's peace and joy with the coming snow. What a surprise. And in a year that we experienced one of the most devastating storms I can remember in my lifetime, God gave us this bookend on the year. Before the storm came a rainbow, after the storm came a double rainbow, and as this year is coming to a close, we had a peace like we had not heard or known in a long time. Friends, God wants to bring peace into your midst. And we know the rest of the story and the way that it goes, right? We know that Jesus has come. We know that He has died, that He has been raised from the dead. And we have seen the story of His ministry and His life and His crucifixion and resurrection changing the world over the last 2,000 years. And we know that one day He will come again. We are the bearers of that story, and joy is contagious. And so let me ask you, where do you need joy where there's been despair? Where can you find great things happening when you couldn't see anything before? Where do you need to give thanks to God like Elizabeth instead of going, "How do I know that this is really going to happen, Gabriel? Come on. I mean, you were in the presence of God and you got the word and you flew all the way down here," right? We all need more joy because God is bringing about peace. And we need to sing the song with Zechariah, that this peace has already come to pass even before it's completely fulfilled. We alone as Christians are the ones that can bear this good news that changes the world. There are a lot of choral arrangements to this Benedictus, so I'm not going to even try to sing one of them. But there is a song that is based off of this text. We know it is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. The first two verses especially. I want to play just an excerpt of the song, and I want you to reflect as we close on the joy of the Lord at work in your life. Let's give it a listen. Lord, we thank you for this amazing story and this prophecy that reminds us of the life-changing, world-changing ministry and mission of Jesus Christ. Lord, we have the privilege of knowing the way that that story has ended, and we know the other bookend, that he will come again in glory to usher in eternity and bring in the new age. Lord, help us to be the ones with the story on our lips that show the joy of the Lord, that find the things that you're doing and point others to it, because joy is contagious. Drive away the dark of doubt. Free us to serve you with gladness and righteousness all of our days. Forgive us, Lord, when we have chosen the negative or we've sought to let our own disappointment undermine the great things that you're already doing. And help us to live today as if tomorrow has already come to pass. God, thank you for this great gift. We love you. We trust you, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.